Hi everybody, and welcome to my session on introducing solids into your baby's diet. My name's Emily Dupuche, and I'm the author of a recipe book for baby and toddler meals called Food Babies Love. This is it. So today I'm just going to touch on sort of how I got interested in this area. I'm a mum of three children. I've got nearly five-year-old twins and a 13-month-old daughter. My twins were born 8 weeks premature, so it was really important to me that I was focused on trying to help build them up beyond just breastfeeding. And I, you know, they little babies we know are often more susceptible to illness, and they're also not necessarily the greatest of sleepers. So I was forever trying to fill them up and get them to sleep through the night. As a lover of good food myself, it was really important to me that they also developed a healthy attitude towards food, had a positive relationship with it, and a clear understanding of where food comes from. It doesn't come from jars and squeezies. I really have tried to empower my children to make some good eating decisions. I was really proud a few weeks ago. We were at a birthday party and my son came up to me and he said, "Mum, I better not have another piece of cake because I might get a sore tummy." And I was really proud that he was able to make that decision, that although he really wanted another piece of chocolate cake, it wasn't the right decision. With regards to helping them understand where food comes from, I spend a lot of time in my kitchen with my children. They're always in there with me. We talk about the food that I'm preparing, the flavours. I let them touch it, we smell it, and they also have a flick through recipe books, choosing which pictures they think that are appealing to them. All of this kind of behaviour was a natural progression for me, because I am, you know, a confident home cook. But having said that, I was really surprised when I went to do my first purees for the babies, just how nervous I actually was and how emotionally connected I felt with this process, and really kind of stopped in my tracks and asked myself, like, you know, is there a special way to be doing this? I don't want to get it wrong. And in talking with my friends and my mother's group, I've really discovered that those fears and nerves are quite normal. So if you are feeling those, then have no worries. It's perfectly natural. So once I overcame those fears, and I realised that there were no rights or wrongs to any of this, that it was about forging ahead, following some basic guidelines and really doing what works for you and your family, I started to have a ball with it. I was creating some really beautiful meal options that my babies were loving, my friends' babies were loving, and with the support of my amazing network, I ended up with my book, which is great. So just quickly, Food Babies Love is a collection of recipes, tips and advice. It is not a nutritional, you know, an A to Z of guidelines, rules and regulations and do's and don't do's. It's really just trying to inspire you to get cooking fresh, healthy meals for your babies. My philosophy is really simple. Cook fresh, cook often and cook varied. And by virtue of all of that, you will be meeting your baby's needs and exposing them to a wide variety of tastes, colours and textures. Because research shows us that the more tastes a baby has before their first birthday, the larger variety of food this baby will go on to eat throughout childhood, right into adulthood. So it's really about exposing them to that as many as you can in the first 12 months. So today's session, I'll share my successful tips for introducing solids. I'm sure there's a few of you here that are hoping for some sort of a silver bullet. I'm afraid there is none. All children are really different. They have different palates, different appetites, and really different needs. But there are some basic things that will help give you some foundations for them to build on as they grow. So just quickly on getting started, this isn't going to be a step-by-step guide on how to do it. That's sort of all detailed in the book. But just a note, guidelines are fluid. They do state somewhere between 4 to 6 months. You do need to use some mother's intuition on this. You know, they'll look for the signs that your baby's giving you, such as following your hand-to-mouth action when you're eating, reaching out for your food. Perhaps they're waking in the night for another feed or not lasting the distance between their regular milk feeds. If when you start, you feel that they're not quite ready, that they're fussing and they're not interested, then simply wait a few days and try again. There is no set date that your baby will start on solids. My hot tip is make sure that mum and dad and any excited siblings can be there. It is a really special time watching your baby have their first tastes. So try to structure it after a milk feed when they're not too hungry and about an hour before their nap time so that they're not too tired. And then you're sort of, the conditions are looking promising for some success. And make sure you've got your camera charged and ready. Some really important key things. Start small, tiny tummies, tiny portions. The baby's gag reflex will still be pretty prominent, so there'll be a lot of tongue thrusting and not much swallowing, and that's okay and normal as well. Your baby needs to learn how to swallow rather than suck. It's quite a different muscle action. don't rush the introduction. You need to stick with one food for 2 or 3 days to allow any reactions to come to the surface, and also note that it can take up to 10 times of presenting the same food for your baby to actually show an interest in eating it. So once you're through those sort of first few weeks of early purees, that's when the challenge really begins. And there are times it can all sort of feel a bit like Groundhog Day, but there's a few things to help you manage it on an ongoing basis. So number one, planning and organisation. Any successful project needs good planning and organisation. So start by creating a meal plan. Choose about 4 meals that you're going to serve over the course of that week. Write your shopping list, have a cooking session, and then cube and freeze. That gets all the work and mess out of the go in one way, and it allows you to sit calmly with your baby, feed them, smile, talk to them, and really kind of help to set the foundations for that family meal time. Stick your meal plan up on the fridge so that you know what you're doing when you're doing it. Any carers, that like partners, husbands, grandparents, they all know what's happening and when as well. With regards to your mealtime routine, just choose one that you're going to follow. If you're following a sleeping routine, then maybe stick to the timings of your sleep guru. Or if you're not, just choose some timings that are going to work for your family, but stick to them so it becomes a pattern that your baby is aware of as well. Organisation also applies to snacks. Have a good supply of them on hand so that when you go out, you're not caught short and reaching for some convenient packaged options. French toast, savoury muffins, mini frittatas, homemade muesli bars, fresh chopped fruits. These are all good options. They freeze well, they store well, and they're much better than those commercial options. Preparation and storage equipment. There is a plethora of stuff out there and you don't need it all. So it's just about making some wise decisions early on and not filling your kitchen up with stuff you don't need. You do need a good stick blender. They come... They cater for all budgets, so just choose one that suits your needs. But from early purees, beautiful thick hearty soups and fruit smoothies, it'll come in really handy. A good peeler. So many of us have peelers that are old, they've been languishing in the drawer for quite some time. They're often a little bit rusty. Get yourself a nice fresh new one and perhaps look for one that does tomatoes and pumpkin because they are available and they're a great time saver. A grater, same again, they're so often sitting in the back of cupboards a bit rusty, and grating veggies is a really good trick as your baby gets older, so again, you might need a new one of those. A microwave steam jug with lid, great time-saving device. Many a pot I have destroyed by burning fruit that I was trying to steam when I was very sleep-deprived with twins. Ice cube and food storage trays. These are imperative for those of us that love the convenience of frozen cubes. A good product like this, you need to make sure that it has a good sturdy lid that will stack well in your freezer and is easy to fill and easy to remove the cubes. I can't recommend cubing food highly enough. It just provides such a convenient way for you to move forward with all of this. And a food processor or chopper. Now again, these come in all shapes and sizes with very different price tags. Just choose one that suits your kitchen storage capacity and also your budget. I'm a big fan of just the simple Tupperware Turbo Chef. It's only about that big. You can take it anywhere. It doesn't need any power. You just use your you pull a string actually to operate it, and allows you to progress from quite smooth food to chunky textures. It's great for taking on holidays. I take mine camping with me. It's a really handy little device. Dress for success. Feeding kids is a messy business and there's not really any way of avoiding it. However, you can use some functional equipment to help overcome that, make cleaning less of a chore, and also help to increase your child's confidence and give them a, help them progress through mastering self-feeding, which ultimately reduces the time you need to invest in sitting and feeding them. What do I recommend? A drop sheet. Just a simple sheet of calico that you put out under the high chair. At the end of the meal, you fold it up, take it outside and shake, and just throw it through the machine every couple of days. Feeding smocks. I can't recommend these highly enough. They help to avoid you changing outfits after each meal. They protect the sleeves and the neckline from the worst of it. And if you get a good one that your baby doesn't even really feel like they're wearing, they have no issues in wearing it meal after meal. Bibs. You need to get good hard plastic bibs. Cotton ones or fabric ones do little to protect from wetness, and that just results in the wetness seeping through to their clothes, and then they're sitting in wet clothes, which ultimately leads to chest infections. Get a good quality hard plastic bib with the catcher that stays open. If it flops forward, then it's not going to do the job either, particularly when they're learning to drink from a cup and the water's spilling out and it's just falling onto their lap and down their chest. bowls or plates. Again, these really can make a difference to their confidence. I think more important than a suction base or a cutesy design is one that has an internal edge that allows them to get some leverage with their spoon. It saves them chasing the food around the bowl, and which ultimately leads to frustration, and they often give up. So if you can find one that has an internal edge, it gives them some leverage, they pick it up. And same for the spoon. You need one that has a good wide scoop on it so that by the time it wobbles to their mouth, there's a hope that there might be some left. Again, helping them in their confidence in mastering self-feeding. And don't use metal spoons. They can heat transfer from the warm food can burn your baby's mouth. So again, always plastic. Next hot tip, boundaries and parameters. This might sound a little bit odd, but it's actually really important. We all know that babies and children thrive under routine. It helps them to give them a greater sense of self, increase their self-confidence, which all leads to greater resilience as they grow up. So setting some boundaries and parameters with regards to feeding will help them and you. Let them know who is boss and have some house rules and stick to them firmly. Always put your baby in a high chair to eat. Dress your baby for mealtime, the smock and the bib. If you start from the beginning in with them wearing those, they won't resist it. Always have a cup of water on hand and offer it throughout the meal. Don't offer milk or juice. These just reduce appetite and add unnecessary sugar to their diet. Always wash your hands and your baby's hands before a meal and clean them up well afterwards. Wipe their hands and face. Your child should never have the upper hand with regards to this. It's a basic hygiene process. If they try to fuss about the bib, then tell them no bib, no food, and be clear about it. And trust me, it does work. When they start to get mobile, insist that all snacks are eaten sitting down. Again, it's a real bugbear of mine to see children walking around houses with food. It just spreads crumbs and sticky fingers all over the place. Again, it's hygiene. It could lead to ants. It's just not a good way to sort of move forward with it. Listening to myself, I think I sort of sound a bit like a cleanliness freak, but actually I'm not. I actually dislike cleaning. So if I can do anything, including instilling in my children some good habits, then I will. Anything to avoid cleaning. Also, don't be afraid to talk sternly to your baby. Children actually pick up on a lot. They know more than we give them credit for, especially vocal tones. If you talk to them in a stern voice, if you're, you know, give them a good sharp no, they will stop in their tracks and listen to you. So, you know, don't feel like a bit of a goose getting cross at a 5-month-old, because I've done it and it does change their behaviours. Help them to understand why you're saying no to them as well, and explain the consequences to them. Again, it's really important for children of all ages to understand that not that just mum or dad saying no to me, but why I can't do a certain thing. It's like I'm always telling my children not to walk around the house or run with holding a pencil or a fork. And that's because, you know, if they fall, they could stab themselves in the eye. It happened to family friends of ours. It's a real thing. So if now that they understand that, they're very good at making sure they don't do it. I can see your face. It's true. She lost an eye from a pencil. Choices. I wish I had a dollar for every time a parent has said to me, oh, I have a fussy eater. Of course, the answer to that is not always simple, but when I probe further, there's usually a common theme, and that common theme is choices. The first thing to look at if you have a fussy eater is to whether or not you're taking away the main course that you've served and offering a slightly more delicious second course like sweetened yogurt or pureed fruit. And usually or often that yogurt might be a Disney-endorsed or Nickelodeon-endorsed yogurt that somehow that's even more delicious. Kids and babies are really canny, and they quickly learn that if they're not going to eat their first one and they resist, then mum and dad will bring something even tastier as second course. So if this is you, then it's time for tough love. You need to stand firm and say you haven't eaten your dinner, you're not getting any yogurt or any fruit. And there might be a few hard nights, some tears and rumbling tummies, but truly, like most things with parenting, you remind them who's boss and you stick to it. They have to have a really good go at their first course before they can earn their second course. Of course, there are always exceptions, and if you are concerned about your baby's dietary intake, then do consult your health professional. Flavour and visual appeal. This might just be the silver bullet that you're hoping for. All too often, people serve their babies bland food and they don't like it. I strongly believe this. Boiled chicken, plain vegetable purees, boring combinations and far too many jars and squeezies. Doesn't sound particularly appetizing, does it? As a basic rule, if you're not prepared to eat it yourself, then don't offer it to your baby. Baby food should be prepared lovingly in the same way you cook for yourself. Follow the steps, go through the motions, treat each ingredient as it deserves to be. You need to work with it to release its natural sweetness. Saute onion and garlic, roast your pumpkin, build up that flavour profile and create a delicious meal that your baby will enjoy. Don't be afraid of using gentle herbs and spices. These are a great way to enhance flavour without relying on salt. Using fresh herbs is great for garnishes. It can lift a simple puree to a whole new level from a flavour perspective, but also a visual appeal. Just having that little sprinkling of green chopped parsley can make a big difference to your baby. Serve tasty food and you will be rewarded. I know there's been times I've been guilty of really quick throw-togethers that taste pretty ordinary. And my kids' faces tell me, you know, they're not that into it. But when I take the time and prepare a proper meal, they absolutely devour it. A note on packaged food. You've heard me refer a few times to these. Whilst I do appreciate the convenience, I'm not a supporter of them. They have a high water content and are heat treated to lengthen shelf life, but most importantly, they taste really ordinary. I don't know if any of you have ever tasted them, but on the one occasion that I was forced to on the way home from a bush camping trip, I'd run out of all the meals I'd bought. We got caught short, I had to buy them. My 9-month-old twins at the time had one taste and refused to eat anymore, so I thought I'd better give it a go, and I could hardly bring myself to swallow it, and this was a really well-known brand of these things. So, you know, I know personally I don't like to buy my meat and veg off the supermarket shelf. I like my meat out of the fridge, and I go to the fruit shop for my fruit and veg. So, you know, again, if you're not prepared to eat it yourself, don't offer it to your baby. Eatability and texture, just really quickly on this. If your baby is struggling, then look at at the texture of the food. Is the meat too tough? Really tenderise your meat well. Give it a good hard bash around before you cook it up. If they're feeding themselves and food's falling off the spoon, then try a little trick like a teaspoon of ricotta or something like that to help it bind on the spoon so that they get that reward when they've gone to all that effort of bringing the spoon to their mouth. And the meal texture overall, if they're struggling, I have no qualms in suggesting that you take it away and chop it up or puree it a little bit more finely, because gag reflexes can be quite prominent for some time in children, and again, they all develop at a different rate in that respect. Smile and talk to your baby. It sounds simple, but it's really important in helping them develop a positive relationship with food. Babies learn a lot about the world from our reactions to things. So always smile at them, talk about the food you're serving, the flavours, the colours. Let them smell it, rub herbs together in your fingers and let them smell that. You can talk about things like carbohydrates being good for energy, protein for brain and muscle development, calcium for strong teeth and bones, nutrients to make us healthy. These are all building blocks for our body. So it helps them, let them become familiar with these terms and understand that food is fuel for our body, for learning, for growing, for playing. Finally, use that consistent messaging around food and sit with your child so you're really building that family meal. So in conclusion, the reality of feeding children is it can be really difficult, and not all kids will like everything, but serve tasty food and you will be rewarded. It might take months or it might take years, but you will get there eventually. So I hope I've given you some useful tips to take away here. Does anybody have any questions? No? Great. Covered it all then. Thank you.